Hello, in this video I'm going to be talking to you about the DNS server configuration and the details, the different details of the DNS configuration on a Windows Server 2008 R2 machine and what each of these settings mean and when you should attempt to change them. So to do this I've opened the DNS console and I'm going to the properties of the DC01 machine here in our lab, and the first tab of the properties window lists the IP addresses over which the DNS server is listening for queries. So you can specify a specific IP address, you can specify that it only works over this IPv4 address, or you can say any and all IP addresses that I will configure on this machine so it works on all of the interfaces, on all of the IP addresses configured on the servers. But you can specify a specific one as well, so it will only respond over that IP address. Forwarders is the second tab, and it's an important functionality. Basically, the forwarder DNS servers are external DNS servers or other DNS servers in the environment that know about external domains, which this DNS server does not know about. So we have the forward lookup zones and the reverse lookup zones. And these are the zones that we are authoritative for, and when a query comes to us we will do our best to resolve that query by looking at the zones that are configured on the local DNS server. If a query comes to this DNS server that is not for any of these zones, it will then be sent to the forwarder that is specified here. Now there is a new concept that was introduced in 2008, and it's conditional forwarders. That is, for specific domains you can specify DNS servers that will respond to queries there. For example, you can say for google.com queries, for any host names that need to be resolved under that domain name, go to this DNS servers specifically and don't go to the general forwarder that we have configured on this tab here. So the forwarders that you see here are general forwarders, but the way that the DNS server will work is that it will first go to the most specific configuration setting, and it will first look at the conditional forwarder, see if there is an exact match for that zone in there. If not, it will use the general forwarders that are configured here. And there's an important setting here. This checkbox configures is used to configure if you should be using the routines in addition to the forwarders. Now, if the DNS server has access to the public internet, or it is a DNS server that works in a large domain environment, you can have root DNS servers, or you could be using the root servers on the public internet. When the forwarder is not able to resolve your query, or is not available, that forwarder DNS server is not reachable, then the DNS server will do its normal recursion and it will go to the root hints servers specified here. And these are basically DNS servers that host the dot domain, which is the root domain. In early times, when Windows 2000 first came out, actually there used to be the root domain automatically configured when you installed Active Directory with a DNS server on a Windows 2000 machine. What it would do is it would create the root domain, so if it wasn't able to find any other DNS service in the environment or there was no internet access, it would automatically configure the machine to be the root server itself and act as the ultimate basically root of all DNS resolution, and that would basically create this local name resolution space. That's changed now. On 2003-2008 machines you don't get that automatically created for you, and the root hints are accessible and are configured by default. So all these a.rootservice.net, b.rootservice.net and everything, they host the root domain. And if you do not know about a specific DNS server that hosts a domain, this DNS server will go to the root server, ask for top level domain referrals, like find a .com service, for example, or .net service or .org service, and then it will take that information, go to the next DNS server in the referral, keep the recursion process going until it finds the exact authoritative DNS server for a given domain name. The next tab that I want to talk about is the Advanced tab, and this specifies how the DNS server certain functions work. When you say disable recursion, for example, you basically disable the ability for this DNS server to do forwarding or routines or any recursion, which basically means stepping through all of the delegations that are configured external to this organization. So stepping through DNS servers until you find the authoritative one. There's the bind secondaries that could be enabled for compatibility with existing bind DNS servers that may exist in an environment. And then there's the setting which says fail on load if bad zone data. If there's a corruption in the zone data, it will fail to load the zone, so you don't serve corrupt record data to clients. And then you have the round robin and netmask ordering, and there's the cache pollution security setting. Now, going through these, the round robin is basically a setting that controls if you have multiple host records that basically point to the same host name. For example, you could have a under the local techutube.com domain, you can have three www records, for example, and they may be pointing to different IP addresses. So what you're trying to do there is, for each of those IP addresses, with the enabling of the round robin mechanism in DNS, as each new client comes to the DNS server, the order of those records will be changed. So the next client that comes to the DNS server gets the next one in the queue. The top served record is basically moved to the end of the list, and round robin works like a basic, you know, load balancing mechanism. And then there is the netmask ordering. Basically, this is again a similar setting, and based on the client's IP address and the network. It is part of the network ID that it is part of, a relevant record is given to that client. So for example, if there are multiple records and the client comes in, the best matching or the nearest network mask matching record is given to that client, so you get the nearest server that you are looking for with the enabling of the netmask ordering. To demonstrate what the cache pollution setting is, I'm going to use a Microsoft support article. This is one that applies to 2000 server, but the idea is still the same, and the ID of this article is 316786. Now, there's a good example of what cache pollution is. When the DNS server does recursion, and this recursion leads to no answers, the DNS server finds the name server through the, you know, routines or the forwarders or what have you, and then for example.com, it gets a name server record that is ns.isp.com, and then to resolve this ns.isp.com, it needs to go and check the IP address record, the A record for this machine name, and then it will cache this if you do not have the cache pollution protection on. By default in 2003, 2008 and above, the cache pollution protection is on, and you will not cache the IP address for a given domain name if it is not within the same domain name. For example, in this example.com domain, the name server for this example.com domain is not in the same domain name, it's isp.com. So that is a security concern, and this, the name server record here, this additional record that is being sent back to our DNS server, is not going to be cached by us, and we're going to keep asking for this name whenever we need to. And that's an example of you know, how the cache pollution protection works. So this article, if you want to read this article, it is again 316786 on the supportmicrosoft.com website. Going back to the settings here, as we talked before, the routines are you know, as they are, and they are used for the main operation of DNS, which is recursion to find a given FQTN. The next tab that I want to talk to you about is the debug logging tab. Now, this is going to generate a file that you can look into as if it was a network trace. It basically logs all the incoming, outgoing DNS queries that it receives, and you can then use this information that it receives for, you know, analyzing if there are any problems with the DNS with the DNS server. But I would recommend using Microsoft Network Monitor instead of the debug logging, because this is basically very much like what you would normally get from the Network Monitor application, and not much else is presented to you here. What is more interesting is the event logging. So there are levels here: no events, errors only, errors and warnings, and all events. You may specify what level of information that you want to be logged for the DNS server. You can specify that here. There is the trust anchors setting, and this is to do with DNSSEC, the secure version of the DNS protocol. This is something that you know, we are going to be talking in a future video, so I'm going to leave it here. DNSSEC is a very interesting subject. It's the DNS protocol itself is very insecure, the way that we use it on the internet today, and DNSSEC makes the whole process of resolving names over the internet and within local networks much more secure. So it's an important topic that we're going to make a video on in the future. I'm going to leave that for now. Monitoring is basically you're testing the functionality of the DNS server. Simple query against this server and recursive query to other DNS servers are basically, as you know, they mean. Simple query against this DNS server is you ask a question to the DNS server about one of the zones that it hosts. Recursive query is a test query to a DNS server that is configured as forwarders or one of the routines. If you don't have the routine resolution enabled, or the forwarders are not configured on the DNS server, you will not be able to get a response from the recursive query test, and that will fail. However, in any case, the simple query against the DNS server itself, the first one, should generally pass. On the security tab, you can see that the DNS server itself is considered as a container, and you can specify who can create child objects, delete child objects, or read and write the configuration, or change you know, record data. This is by default given to the DNS admins, and domain admins have full, enterprise admins have control. Again, you can specify a person to be a local DNS administrator by adding them to the DNS admins group, and they would have almost unlimited access to the DNS server only, and they would be able to manage the DNS servers. Thank you for listening.